Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. God hears us when we cry and draws us close to Jesus Christ. So let us return to the one who is full of compassion. Fountain of living water, you search us, you know us. Pour out your mercy over us. Our sin is heavy, and we long to be free. Rebuild what we have ruined, mend what we have torn. Wash us in your cleansing flood. Make us alive in the Spirit to follow the way of Jesus. As healers and restorers of the world that you so love. Amen. And beloved, God's word never fails. The promise rests on grace. By the saving love of Jesus Christ, the wisdom and the power of God, your sins are forgiven, and God remembers them no more. Journey now in the way of Jesus.
A reading from Genesis. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you, throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be to God, to you, and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, As for Sarai, your wife, you should not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of people shall come from her. The word of the Lord.
Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according
according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which is already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words that was reckoned to him were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord.
Text. Because here we have two great ideas in competition. We have the idea of Jesus is going to spread something called the kingdom of God. And on the opposite side of that is the kingdom of the world. It's interesting insofar as when he predicts what's going to happen to him, what his ultimate end is going to be, Peter is astounded. Takes a lot of imagination to stop and think that after Jesus says all of this about his life, Peter, who has watched Jesus perform miracles, who has watched Jesus and the crowds that follow him, feels that he has the right to take Jesus aside and say, "You're wrong. You can't be right." He rebukes Jesus. It's almost laughable when you stop and think about it. That here, this Peter says, "I really do know better than you do." And the rebuke that Jesus gives to him is even stronger, more strident. Peter, who would, after the resurrection of Jesus, become the chief of the apostles, Peter is told he's like Satan. "Get behind me, Satan." And it's so interesting. no sense in rebelling against Rome. What are we against legions of Roman soldiers? But nevertheless, there is that sense of grandeur about it that even those who are under subjugation can't help but say, this is something really grand and majestic. And here comes this Jesus turning the whole world upside down and says, but this isn't how it was meant to be. The meek shall inherit the earth, outrageous, idiotic, making no sense. The poor in spirit, no thank you. Because as history unfolds, we know very well, it's not the pure in spirit that have ruled. It's not those who have conquered other people and ruled over them. There's no humility there. There is nothing but power, and all too often, death. So, when we look at this text at this point in time in Lent, we are confronted with a basic mystery of how God sees creation and how God sees the world. And it isn't the same world that Peter is seeing right in to himself right now. And that's why Jesus' rebuke is so quick, so violent. It has to be stopped right at that moment. Go no further, Peter, with this idea of worldly grandeur. I know what you want. You want what the world wants, but I'm not here to preach that type of world. And over again you hear it. Blessed are the poor. Jesus talks more about the poor than about the rich and anything else in all the scripture. He's on the side of those who think there's no one on their side at all. So as we walk into Lent and we consider what we have, what we're called to do, the type of life that we're called into, we always have to be aware that there is the lure of the world that says, no, no. It isn't how Jesus says. If that were so, then the world would be ruled by peaceful, loving people. But it doesn't work that way. So it's always ourselves who are guided and saying, how do I view the world? What do I want for the world? And what is it? And no wonder Jesus at the end of what is spoken in this text says, you know, people are interesting. They will try to save their lives, and then they're going to lose it. But for those who lose their life, they're going to save it. Sounds very mysterious. But for those who are constantly trying to save their life, it's never going to be enough because it's never going to work. And even though it rises to a crescendo of great strength and majesty, all the world knows it's temporary. Because deep down inside all of us, we know that everything we have is on loan. Even the air we breathe is on loan. It is all temporary. And that's something good to reflect on in Lent, especially during what we're going through with this terrible pandemic, what we are going through in this season of testing, so to speak, that somehow we do understand that everything is on. And if that is so, we never owned it in the first place. Peter wants Jesus to own grandeur. He wants Jesus to own what he thinks supremacy must look like, what he envisions the kingdom of God to be like. And that is totally triumphant. What he doesn't know is what Jesus' life is, says, ultimately, it has triumphed. But it goes to another world first, which breaks down and refines perhaps the human spirit. And when we find ourselves with nowhere else to turn, it is only then then stop and realize that you don't want to be on the other side of Jesus having to say, get behind me, Satan. Try it this week. Do I have the mindset that I'm reading here, that I'm hearing in this gospel? And if I don't, what do I want to do next? Let us now profess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and he descended into the dead. And on the third day he rose again, and he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us pray. Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the Church, for the world, all who are in need.
Lord, listen to your children pray. Lord, send your Spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray.
Give new believers joy in your promises. Give hope and courage to those who suffer for their faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All the ends of the earth worship you, from galaxies to microorganisms. Preserve your creation. Teach humanity to wonder at your works and to join you in tending to creation's well-being. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Raise up advocates for peace and justice within and between nations. Give life when hope seems dead. Call into existence new realities we cannot even imagine. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In Jesus, you joined humanity in suffering and death. Reveal to all the depth of your love shown on the cross. Accompany all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Restore all who are sick and grieving. Bring vindication for victims of injustice, exploitation, and oppression. Today especially do we name Karina Broome and her newborn daughter Elizabeth, the family of Paul Bukovich,
Now, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You are what God made you to be, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, decreed to serve your neighbor. God bless you, that you may be a blessing.
Share the good news.
Thanks be to God.